Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
How's everybody today?
Dandy.
Good.
Great. God, that's dandy. That's good. That sounds uplifting anyway. Anyway, good afternoon. Last week with this series, The Cold War, four talks set in the Cold War, we did the United States, how it took on its, it becomes a global power, then to a superpower by 1945, and we go up to approximately 1950 or so. Talking about George Kennan as well, the author of something known as Containment, also a co-author of the Marshall Plan, did that. Today we're going to do Russia, the competitor, if you will, after 1945. And I would assume some of you will probably think it's still a competitor here, politically, militarily, so on and so forth. Yeah, you're probably not that far off. It is. But how do we get here? We're going to talk about Russia up to approximately 1950 or so. But how do we get here? If you look at that handout, a lot of this progression is traced geographically. And you'll notice the first map that I put in is actually old Russia, going back to almost Kievan Rus. We're not going to go back that far, but I put that map there just to show the progression since Kievan Rus, which, you go back to 880-900 AD. It's a long time that Russia was putting itself together. And what you see through Russian history here, you get into the Romanovs, the 17th century, when the Romanovs first take power. This idea of, remember that idea of manifest destiny here, this great expansion across this great land? Interesting. The Russians are basically doing the same thing. Only they're doing it over a longer period of time. And on a landmass that's noticeably bigger than ours.
Yes.
I mean, how many time zones is the United States?
Right.
I mean, even with Hawaii, we don't even come close to the amount of time zones in Russia, which was even more with the Soviet Union. Was it somebody said 19 time zones? Holy mackerel. Boy, talk about having your sleep messed up. But anyway, you see here this growth and manifest destiny in Russia, because Moscow, or Moscovoy, if you want to use that, is moving east, west, north, south at this point. Now keep in mind, in the 18th century, and that's where we're really going to start here, let's start with the British. I mean, those of you who have attended earlier talks of mine, I go back to this idea of the great game, which the British were playing with Tsarist Russia at one point, France, Germany will become a competitor here. This idea of salvaging the British Empire. And the British do not like competition. As if you want to call that the world's greatest empire, that's arguable here. But, the one point the British are what? One quarter of the world, of the globe? That saying, the sun never set on the British Empire, remember that one? Rule Britannia, Britannia rule the waves. And of course, the engine for growth with that is the Royal Navy. However, that said, in 1763, the British are going to indulge their Indian Empire by moving west. Now, the British, again, know how to read a map, that thing called geography here. And they notice that there's two rivers in Mesopotamia, the Tigris and the Euphrates River. Well, the idea here is if a colonial interloper or a competitor or a kibitzer, if you want to use that terminology, goes down those two rivers into the Persian Gulf out of the Strait of Hormuz, you're in the Arabian Sea. Hence, colonial India. Now it's Pakistan, but that doesn't exist then. That's the last thing the British want. It's the crown jewel of their empire. So they begin to move west. And in 1763, the British East India Company will set up shop in Basra in southeastern Mesopotamia, now known as Iraq. And 5 years later, a British consulate will follow suit. And in 1798, they will set up shop in Baghdad. They're moving northwest here. 4 years later, another British consulate will set up shop here. At the same time as the Russians are expanding, you know, Catherine the Great, Catherine II, you know, she's going to wipe Poland, finish wiping Poland off the map here by 1795, the Polish partition. But she's also moving south. And it's interesting here what you see here in the development 1774. An accord called Kutchuk-Kanyarja. And I don't expect you to remember that name, but that's the accord that exists. And what Russia gets out of this from the Ottoman Empire, keep in mind the Ottoman Empire is beginning to totter, well, they've been tottering for a while. And the reason they're tottering is, part of that is that 100-year war they had with the Safavid Persians for control of Mesopotamia. You know that saying, the 100 years war in Europe, right? Which that terminology does not come along until the 19th century. There were actually four or five wars between 1357 and 1453, I think it is. 1337 to 1453 in Europe. You know, where the British claimed the French throne. That made the French happy. And so you're going to have four or five wars. Well, in the 19th century, these historians come along and just lump it together and call it the 100 Years War. The same thing happens here in the Middle East, where the Ottoman Turks, Sunni Muslims, are going to be fighting the Safavid Persians, Shia Muslims, and they're Persians, they're not Arabs. In fact, Turks aren't Arabs either. And so who's bouncing back and forth here like a badminton bird? Arabs. They don't control their own destiny here. But in between, whenever the Safavid Persians took control of Mesopotamia, Shia Muslims were under a thumb. Whenever the Ottoman Turks took control of this, the Shia Muslims were under a thumb, helping to accentuate what you call the Sunni-Shia split. And so what happens here is, when you fight for 100 years or so, doesn't your country get weaker after a while? Yeah, it does. It does. And so the Ottomans are prone to being pushed, channeled, pulled, and pushed and pulled by larger powers. Tsarist Russia is no different. They're looking to expand here. And with this treaty, Kutchuk-Kanyarja, they get access into the Black Sea. Or also the Crimea is supposed to be independent, but we know where that's going. Also, the Eastern Orthodox Church will oversee Christian interest in the Middle East. Boy, that makes the Vatican happy. Of course, Napoleon III is going to reverse that in the early 1850s, and by having the Catholic Church have primacy for Christian interest in the Middle East, but we're going to talk about that in a few minutes. And so you see Russia trying to move south. And the British do not want them there, which is why in the 19th century, the British will still support the Ottoman Empire, even though it's collapsing, because they are a buffer to Tsarist Russia. But at the same time, it's interesting here because in 1789, the French Revolution starts, right? One of the two big revolutions, the American Revolution, the French Revolution. And part of the rationale for these revolutions is that, these revolutions are based off the ideas of the Age of Reason, Age of Enlightenment. And, these ideas are not they don't originate here of the French Revolution. Ideas of liberalism, democracy, republicanism, secularism, socialism, nationalism, parliamentarianism, where people have the temerity to sit in assemblage, in a Congress or a Duma or a parliament, whatever you want to call it, or have representatives to perform the same function for their agenda. Instead of having being ruled by a faceless monarch who's casting these edicts from down on high, and he or she doesn't care about them in the first place. And Catherine the Great was really afraid of these ideas. In fact, it's interesting what she does here. And I always find this as kind of a forerunner of a fascist state, if you will. And she accords various areas of Russia under noble control. Keep in mind, serfdom still exists here. It won't be abolished till 1861. And these nobles are almost autonomous islands where, they're autonomous rulers. It's interesting. And they run different sections of Russia, especially the land. Russia's looking to modernize here perhaps politically, perhaps socially, militarily, but economically, it's because of this. They maintain serfdom, and you know, as the Industrial Revolution snowballs here, especially in Britain, which is going to help make the British the ranking economic power. Russia, you know, end of the 18th, going through the 19th centuries, is going to fall farther and farther and farther behind. Interesting what you see develop here. So you see, under a monarch, a more or less, it's almost like a fascist sort of political structure here. Because what's fascism? Go to Mussolini's fascist Italy. Okay, he's the head honcho. But what happens here? You see big corporations running their sections of the Italian economy at the expense of what? Small and medium businesses? Yeah. And they run those sections of the economy. So it's the same thing that Catherine is, almost the same type of thing that Catherine's doing with these nobles. And they keep the people in indentured servitude. Well, they're in serfdom, so they're not in indentured servitude. They're stuck to the land. And a man by the name of Alexander Radishev writes a book, 1790, I think it is. It's called Journey from St. Petersburg to Moscow. I've never read this book, but it supposedly trumpets the idea of the ideas coming out of the French Revolution, liberalism, democracy, secularism, so on and so forth. He's locked up. He's going to be arrested in jail. So Russia is looking to modernize, but not at the expense of the ruling clique. That sound familiar? Interesting what you're seeing develop here, but it does retard Russia internally. Sure, she's taking her place on this world stage as a world power. She's doing that now. But there's another issue for Russia. As they expand in their version of manifest destiny, they are taking control of areas on this Eurasian landmass of people who are not Russian. Yeah, you're right. Crimean Tatars, maybe some Romanians, Lithuanians, Latvians, Estonians, some Finns, some Poles. Do you think these people want to be called Russian? I remember my aunt telling me one time, you know, my background's German, Swedish, Irish, and English. Yeah, I'm a mutt. My wife likes to trumpet the fact that she's 100% Italian-American extraction. Yeah, okay. And I remember my aunt, because you know, my mother was my father was Swedish and Irish and a little English, and my mother was more or less German with some Irish. And I remember my aunt was married to my Uncle Bill, my mother's youngest brother. And my aunt, though, by marriage, was for the most part Ukrainian. And I remember I was 14 years old and I told her, well, you know how boys are. I told her, I said, I don't understand you. She goes, what's that? She goes, how could a Ruski marry a squarehead? She says, young man, I am not a Ruski. I am Ukrainian. I never forgot that one. Never forgot that one. And so, so it's interesting here what you see, even here. And she was born here. You know, her grandparents came from Ukraine. So it's interesting how this idea of ethnic background resonates years later. Interesting here. It's absolutely fascinating. But you see, this is going to be a problem for the Russians. And so Tsarist Russia has to maintain a draconian approach to rule to keep these people in line. They actually have a secret police force. It's called the Third Section. And that's going to help keep people in line. So it's interesting what you see develop here. And as we go into You know, we go into the Napoleonic Wars, which is the second chapter of the Great French War. The first chapter being 1792 to 1802, the French Revolutionary Wars, where, you know, the monarchs in Europe want to put down these ideas being unleashed by this French Revolution. And this is where you see, I've gone into this in past talks, where you begin to see this thing called levée en masse, where you can no longer rely on just volunteers and professional soldiers anymore. Now, levée en masse, we need to conscript not only the entire economies, but entire peoples for war. And as the Industrial Revolution snowballs, and as technology feeds on itself, every generation of weapon is becoming more and more modern, and we're producing more of them. And they are going to reap a greater harvest of humanity. And so as these weapons, you know, as this evolution proceeds, we need more bodies. One feeds on the other. More weapons, more deaths, and it goes up. And so Russia is involved in this endeavor to put down, you know, the Great French War. However, this gives way, the French Revolutionary Wars give way to the Napoleonic Wars. You know, the French Revolution runs out of steam. This liberal idea gives way to a dictator. He calls himself an emperor, but he's a dictator. Now, if you want to make the case that Napoleon is the first of the modern dictators, you know, perhaps you can go with that. I mean, he's going to have a secret police. He's going to have a secret police chief known as Joseph Fouché. And if you want to use him as being the first of the modern secret police chiefs, not a bad idea. It's kind of a forerunner of what you're going to see coming down the pike with people like Felix Dzerzhinsky, Lavrenty Beria. How about Heinrich Himmler? Yeah. Again, you see what comes down the pike from the original, if you want to use that terminology. And so when Napoleon invades Russia, it's almost like the Great Patriotic War, only it's not called that. You know, General Winter will come to the Russian aid like he will in the winter of 1941. And only this time Napoleon will take Moscow. Only he can't hold it, he's going to be thrown out. And Russia will join that, if you want to use the term crusade, to defeat Napoleon in 1815. And Tsar Alexander I will get into Europe, as will a lot of the other great powers. I always remember Averell Harriman. Averell Harriman, when the Second World War was over with, well, he's our ambassador to the Soviet Union, right? And he's, you know, isn't this his job as a public relations man in this respect? And in 1945, when the shooting stops in Europe, he says to Stalin, he goes, I want to congratulate the Russian people for this great victory. And it was a great victory, there's no doubt about that. The Russian army and your leadership, so on and so forth. Well, you think Stalin would say, well, thank you very much, Mike. Convey my thanks to Franklin D. Roosevelt, and so on and so forth. No, none of that at all. None of that at all. You know, Stalin looks back at him with a face as blank as his floor, and he says, well, you know, because the Russians got to Berlin and Prague, he says, Tsar Alexander got to Paris. What does that tell you? If he had his way, he would have two T-34 tanks would have been parked at the Pas-de-Calais. Imagine the kind of Cold War that would have been if that had happened. It's one of the reasons you're going to have Normandy, to make sure that doesn't happen. We never talk about Normandy that way. We should. And so what you see here is Tsarist Russia will formulate Europe after the Napoleonic Wars, the Congress of Vienna, right? And Tsar Alexander I is a big proponent of the so-called Holy Alliance. True, you're going to have the major alliance of Tsarist Russia, the Habsburgs, Austria, Prussia, England, and France will be admitted to this too when the Bourbons are back on the throne, of the monarchs overseeing a new balance of power in Europe of which Russia is a part. The Holy Alliance is like a sub-alliance between Tsarist Russia, the Habsburgs, Austria, and Prussia. Now note the religious makeup. Eastern Orthodox, Catholic, Protestant? Lutheran, if you want to call it that. Interesting makeup there. interesting makeup there. And in the late, you know, the going into 1820, the two Sicilies in Italy, which is not Italy yet, but that principality is in revolt. And so, you know, the Austrians will send troops there to put it down. But the Holy Alliance, they work with each other here to oversee Eastern and Central Europe, and the Austrians will offset with the French to keep an eye on the Italian boot, so to speak, to make sure it stays in the fold. However, there is going to come a time where that alliance is going to be called into question and literally fall apart. And that comes from the Crimean War. Nobody talks about this war. It's kind of forgotten. And yet, from 1853 to 1856, 500,000 men are going to be killed in this war. 500,000 men, 300,000 by sickness, disease, so on and so forth. And so, you know, once Napoleon III, again, who takes power in France, is trying to bring France back as a great power after the fall of Napoleon I. So he's trying to bring France back as a power, and he twists the Ottoman arm, and then the Catholic Church will oversee Christian interests in the Middle East, so on and so forth. But Tsarist Russia is still looking to expand, and they're going to move into that area known, what's going to be known later as Romania. That's still part of the Ottoman Empire, by the way. And so the French will go to war, and the British will join them. Now, keep in mind here, there's no honor among thieves here. No, I mean, it's interesting how the sides are chosen up here. Tsarist Russia on one side, which is basically Eastern Orthodox, against the Ottomans, the British, and the French. Now, the French are what, Catholic for the most part? And what are the Ottomans? Muslim. And the British are what?
Protestant.
Anglican, Protestant. Boy, there's a group. There's a group. Of course, the Russians are going to be defeated. But again here, you know, Napoleon III is looking to resurrect France as a great power. They're going to supply a lot of the ground troops. Who do you think is going to supply a lot of the naval power? The British, right. And so what are the British doing? Yeah, they're supporting the French. They're also going to keep an eye on them, too, because they don't trust them much more than they do the Russians. Again, they're moving into the Middle East. They don't like kibitzers here. But what happened to that Holy Alliance that Russia had with Prussia and the Austrians? And some military historians say that if the Austrians and the Prussians had joined the Russians, maybe that could have been the start of a great war in Europe. It doesn't happen. Keep in mind, Prussia and Austria are dicing here. This is 1853, 1856. What came out of the Congress of Vienna was German dualism. Where you see here, where you see, you know, the Austrians are overseeing the southern German states and the Prussians are overseeing the northern German states. This is called German dualism. Somebody eventually is going to have to rule the roost here. You know, the situation can't go on like this. Obviously, who's going to come and organize the German states? Otto von Bismarck, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm, the Iron Chancellor. And that will be under the tutelage of Prussia. But, you know, when you go, it's interesting, when you go back to the Congress of Vienna, Poland, part of the Tsarist Russian Empire, you know, is considered sort of a kingdom, and Alexander I will actually grant them a constitution. Now, what's fascinating about that setup is he's actually a constitutional monarch in Poland, but he's an absolute in his own country, Moscow. These ideas of liberalism, democracy, republicanism, socialism are beginning to resonate. Of course, there is going to be a crackdown on Poland when they try to grab more than they're allowed. You know, total freedom. That's not happening. In fact, you will see a movement transpire in Russia. It's called the Decembrists movement. In 1825, December 1825, who are looking to liberalize Russia, they're going to be cracked down upon. Have to maintain the iron fist at home. So Russia is not only looking to expand, they have internal problems. But it's interesting here again, fast forward again to the Crimean War. The Russians lose that war. The Ottoman Empire will continue to hold on to territory. Again, they're growing ever weaker, but Britain still sees them as that buffer zone to Tsarist Russia. So that commits the British, the Crimean War is an example here, to actually support the Ottomans if they need to make sure that Russia does not descend further south. But at the same time here, you see Napoleon III set up shop in Mexico. Remember that one? And who's he going to support? Maximilian, who actually comes out of the Habsburg house. And they set him up in Mexico City to oversee Mexico. This is Napoleon III's attempt to try to resurrect the North American Empire. Isn't that against the Monroe Doctrine?
Yeah,
it sure is. But there's not much Abe Lincoln can do about it, because why? Civil War, right? He's got to fight the Confederacy. How's he going to stop the French? He can't. He's got to fight the Confederacy first. Of course, the North will defeat the Confederacy. And in 1865, of course, Lincoln has been assassinated by this point. 1865, the new president, Andrew Johnson, will send 50,000 battle-hardened Union troops down to the Texas border under the command of Phil Sheridan. There is a chance here that we could have gone to war with the French. Won't happen. Why? 1866, Otto von Bismarck organizes the German states under the tutelage of Prussia. No more German dualism. And obviously here, Napoleon III sees the handwriting on the wall. He's got to pull all those troops out of Mexico. Of course, what happens to Napoleon, Maximilian?
1867.
Yeah, that's right. He goes against the firing squad, and that's the end of him. But interesting here, too, you see, during the Civil War, one of our biggest boosters from Europe is Tsarist Russia. They don't want the North to lose. They don't want the North to lose. In fact, they'll make a fleet visit here stateside in 1863. They don't want us to lose. They want the country to stay whole. They want the United States to remain the United States. Why? As a potential ally, perhaps, for any other round of unpleasantness in Europe? If they can't count on Austria, the Habsburgs, and the Prussians against the British and the French, who else can they count on? They know the United States is growing as a power. Perhaps the United States can be that power. That I find fascinating, because we are undergoing our own form of manifest destiny here, expanding across this great continent. And what's fascinating here is, these are the two countries later moving ahead here that are actually going to win what you call the Second World War. That's fascinating. Absolutely fascinating. They're growing as powers now, and yet they're going to win this big war by 1945. Some 80, 85 years down the road. That's interesting. That's interesting. As the United States grows, so does Russia. So does Russia. You're getting closer into the 20th century. Nicholas I, who has a more draconian outlook for rule. Now, keep in mind, even though they do away with serfdom in 1861, that doesn't free the people. You know, 80% of the people live on land, even though Russia's beginning to industrialize here. They really are. In fact, by the end of the 19th century, some 1.6 million Russians will be working in factories. They'll have upwards of 35,000 kilometers of railroad running in Russia by the end of the century. Of course, that's nowhere near what the United States has for railroads. Well, we got about, I think, 166,000 miles of railroad track laid down by the end of the 20th century, end of the 19th century. So Russians are behind the curve, but they're modernizing here. They're modernizing. However, having said that, again, this landed gentry has quite a bit of power. And they control the land. Again, this corporatizing through landed gentry of ownership of the land. The people don't own it. Even though they're not serfs anymore, they are now stuck as indentured servants. And the British are going to do the same thing in Iraq after 1920. They're going to hire these landed sheikhs, these tribal sheikhs of means to run the land and keep the bulk of the people in indentured servitude, overcharging them for the tools, the feed, and the animals, and then underpaying them for what they're growing. And these people are kept in perpetual indentured servitude. And I know in Iraq, they can't break out of this. And if they try to, they're blackballed. I mean, this is a perpetual dungeon that's in Iraq. Well, Russia's not that far different. However, you know, as Germany rises as a power, the British see this. And as they're strengthening their hold in the Middle East, despite the fact the Ottomans are still supposedly an entity, in 1903, the British government, Lord Lansdowne, issues what's known as the Lansdowne Declaration in 1903. You know, the Middle East is becoming more and more important here. Keep in mind, 1901, they get the concession from the Qajar Shah in Persia to drill for oil. Now you know where this is going. And they'll strike oil here in 1909. Because keep in mind, too, the Royal Navy, as you get into the 20th century, is now beginning to wean itself off coal and onto oil to power the Royal Navy. You can get a lot more miles out of a gallon of oil than you can with a pound of coal. You know, the technology has come now where it's cheaper to use oil. And the United States is another one that by 1909, all new American submarines and destroyers will be laid down in the yards with oil-fired power plants. And by 1914, the battleship Nevada will be the first American battleship to burn oil solely. The same Nevada, by the way, which 75th anniversary of Pearl Harbor coming up in 2 days. It's the same Nevada that tried to make that courageous run to get out of the harbor that day. It's the same ship. Kind of an historic American battleship in this regard. Kind of an historic American battleship. So you see this modernization of the world. Again, this is part of the Industrial Revolution snowballing that's affecting the world here. An evolution of technology at the same time. But you see with the Lansdowne Declaration, the British are telling, in particular, Tsarist Russia and Imperial Germany, stay out of the Middle East. It's considered it's considered strategically important to the British Empire. And we will repel any interference by any means necessary, including force. Now, fast forward 77 years later, what does Jimmy Carter come out with in 1980? The Carter Doctrine? Make no bones about what he says. The Middle East is very important to the American strategic agenda. And we will repel any interference here with any means necessary, including force. Some historians say that the Carter Doctrine was taken from Lansdowne's Declaration in 1903. But you see here again, you know, when you look at Persia here, interesting what you see, 1906. That there's a movement in Persia to take out the Qajar Shah or to turn the Qajar Shah into a constitutional monarchy. Well, if the British are got the oil concession, you think they want a democracy or a constitutional monarchy taking power in Persia? No, they don't. They don't. And so working with Tsarist Russia in 1906, 1907, they will divide up Persia. The northern part of the country will be overruled by the Russians, the southern part of the country will be ruled by the British, and a middle or rump section, if you want to call that, will stay under the rule of the Qajar Shah, but you know how that's going to go. They'll do that under the okay of St. Petersburg and London. And so a potential of having a secular rule in Persia eventually goes down the tubes here. I mean, I can imagine what it would have been like having a constitutional monarchy in Persia in 1907, 1908, 1909. What could that have done to the Middle East? Maybe nothing. But then again, we don't know because it doesn't really happen. And what's interesting here too is, again, the British and the Russians are going to roll into Iran in 1941. And then you wonder why the Iranians have a beef against the West. There's historical precedent here that says that perhaps they're justified. But you see here, why would Russia do this? Well, go back to 1905 in Russia. You know, the 1945 Russo-Japanese War by 1905 isn't going too well for Russia. And so, you know, when a country is losing a war or wars and their economy is not too good a shape, they have little, if any, in the way of rights, they are not too politically well represented, and some people are actually hungry, the children aren't being educated, don't you think some people might get antsy here? So in January 1905, Father Gapon leads an entourage of 200,000 or 300,000 people to descend on the Winter Palace. We want a better deal. We want a better deal. More rights, better, you know, better working conditions, so on and so forth. You know the litany that'll come out of this. And what does Tsar Nicholas II do? Yeah, sicks the Cossacks on them. 2,000 or 3,000 people killed or wounded, men, women, children, young, old, whatever the case may be. You think he wants a constitutional monarchy setting up on a southern border if he doesn't want it at home? No. However, he will indulge in a parliament known as a Duma. But within a couple of years, I can't get into that too deeply at this point, but in a couple of years, that's going to be a rubber stamp too. He will retain absolute rule in Russia. Keep in mind, the British monarchy is a constitutional monarchy. It's not absolute at this point. That always got the Kaiser. Kaiser Wilhelm II, his cousin. You know, he is related to Edward VII and later George V. Well, even Tsar Nicholas II was a cousin to Kaiser Wilhelm II. Kaiser Wilhelm's grandmother was Queen Victoria. It is a mafia setup, if you want to use that terminology here. But you know, here's Kaiser Wilhelm II, who's more or less an absolute, and he has his cousin in England, which is constitutional monarchy, but he has the world's largest empire, has the world's largest navy, can go boating every weekend with the world's largest navy anytime he wants. And the jealousy comes up, but that's another story. So you see Russia here, though, beginning to take, and this is interesting, too, because in 1894, they signed an alliance with the French, and now the Germans are in the middle. In 1904, the British and the French will sign an accord. You know, they'll bury their imperialistic differences because of the rise of German power. They will sign an accord, and in 1907, you will see France, Britain, and Russia now as the Triple Entente, as it's called, because the Germans have forged alliances with the Austro-Hungarian Empire and Italy, the Triple Alliance, or the Central Powers, if you want to call them. That term has been used, too. But again, now, you see here, and it's interesting here, too, what you see with Russia. And the Italians are fun here. They really are. They're looking to put themselves in this colonial race. And I get this in 1911. You know, the Ottoman Empire, again, is tottering. And they went into Libya. Nobody else wants Libya. There's nothing here. Of course, this is pre-oil, and everybody wants it. But the British really never struck out from Egypt for it. The French are not going to strike up from Morocco or Algiers for it. Nobody wants it. It's just sand. The Italians do. Got to get into the race here. And so, you know, they're going to contact, get this, they're in the opposite alliance. They contact the Russians. Hey, you don't mind if we go into Libya, do you? No, knock yourself out. Well, if you don't mind that, we won't say anything if you want to take the straits and, you know, that warm water access in the Mediterranean, which the Italians are not going to support anyway. They want an empire. And sure enough, they're going to go to war. September, October 1911 with the Turks. Tripolitania is actually what they're looking for, which is one of the provinces of Libya, which is going to be Libya. And they're going to win that war by September, August, September 1912. That, for those of you who haven't ever heard me say this before, that's actually the first war where an airplane bombs people. That's the first war. and a little Italian Lieutenant Giulio Gavotti in a Taube monoplane attacks two Turkish positions in the Tripolitanian desert. He's got a leather pouch in his lap, having with four Sapelli manufactured hand grenades weighing 4.5 pounds apiece. So the world's first bomb load is 18 pounds. And as he makes two passes over each of his positions, pulling the pin on a grenade and chucking it out of the cockpit. In a plane in which, in reality, your family's sedan goes faster than this plane. But this is the world's first bombing raid. Russia, 1914, you know, after Archduke Franz Ferdinand is assassinated in Sarajevo, him and the Countess Sophie. You know, all these countries tumble into war. Tsarist Russia will go to war with Germany. And this is a country that is the least industrialized, least organized, least prepared for war. I read one source where, you know, where 6 million men are mobilized, 4 million have rifles. How can you function this way? You can bet the Germans are in that fix, or the French, or the British. And this war will reap a grim harvest of humanity with the Russians. One of the reasons you have the Gallipoli operation, where the British send the Anzacs, the Australians and New Zealands, to land on the Gallipoli Peninsula in Turkey and knock Turkey out of the war, was to open up a causeway for supply for Tsarist Russia. That will fail. And I offer to you that by November 1915, when the British cannot effect their Gallipoli landing to success, that's one of the major reasons the Russians will have to bow out by 1917. Of course, what doesn't help the Russians too is in 1916, when the war is at its height at this point, the big battles of Verdun and the Somme on the Western Front, big battles of attrition. I mean, the 10 months in the Verdun alone, upwards of 750,000 men eaten up in 10 months. Dead, wounded, missing, captured, whatever the case may be. The Somme. I mean, July 1, 1916, the first day of the Somme, 60,000 British casualties. It's the worst day in the history of the British Army. 60,000 men in one day. Dead, wounded, it's horrible. Yes?
When you take a look at these huge battles where tremendous numbers of people are lost, with the Russians, they can really put up with a war of attrition.
Oh, the Russian steamrollers, they used to call it.
Because of their vast numbers of civilian populations, and they just keep throwing them at the enemy.
Yeah, like the Chinese did during the Korean War. I mean, you talk to some of these Korean War vets who had to face them. I mean, it's just, you know, one line after another here. And you know, which is why the machine gun and artillery were very important. And then later on, aircraft were very important in staunching these human wave attacks.
So when you take a look at the technology is really important, but also the number of men that the alliances can throw at the enemy.
Correct.
Because if you have technology, you have no one to use it.
Oh, correct. So yes, technology does have a bearing on this, you know, as far as stopping human wave attacks. But here you see, though, in 1916, they implore the Russians to launch a huge offensive on the Eastern Front to take the pressure off the guys in the West. And Alexei Brusilov will lead this offensive in the summer of 1916 against the Austro-Hungarians. He will be reasonably successful. He won't be able to break into that. He won't be able to get through the into Austria-Hungary itself, but he will cause 600,000 Austrian-Hungarian casualties. 600,000 that summer. That cripples the Austro-Hungarian army, but it's going to cost the Russians 1 million men. And by this time, many of the Russians have had their fill of this war. Some of these Russian peasants will just turn around and walk home back to the farm. They've had their fill. So here you begin to see the collapse of Tsarist Russia. And in February 1917, the revolt starts in St. Petersburg. And among the first workers to revolt are women. That's interesting. But I offer to you that this revolution, which starts, many say February 1917, really didn't start in February 1917, but January 1905, outside the Winter Palace. You know, revolutions don't start like this. It's like a movement. It's got a leader. Like our revolution really didn't start 1775 or 1776. Go back to 1764. Again, there's these events, the progression towards upheaval. And so the Bolsheviks will eventually take control of this revolution, which will lead to civil war. And Lenin is the leader of this revolution. And this is the first of the monarchs, the 17th century monarchs, who were going to be put out of business by 1918, 1919. Now the Hohenzollerns in Germany are going to be gone. The Ottomans are going to be gone. The Habsburgs are going to be gone. And so you see what's going on here. A wholesale change in the political structure of Europe. And the Bolsheviks will be part of that. King Victor Emmanuel of Italy, he survives, but who takes power in 1922? Mussolini and the fascists, right? And the ultimate heir to the Kaiser is going to be Adolf Hitler in 1933. And so you see, you know, Lenin beginning to organize Russia. However, he will die in 1924. And then there will be the competition between, we'll call the competition between Stalin and Trotsky, right? Leon Trotsky, the great orator, the great party theorist. Stalin couldn't match him on these grounds. However, you know, Stalin had that so-called innocuous job of being a commissar of government portfolios. And what do you think he's doing? He's staffing all these different government ministries with people who are now going to have to swear allegiance to?
Stalin.
Him. Yeah, that's it, Stalin. So you get to the Party Congress, 1926. Guess who's going to be chosen the new chairman here? Stalin. Trotsky's given his tickets, and he's on his train, and he's out.
Mexico.
That's it. He's eventually going to wind up in Mexico, right? After a tour of different countries. And Saddam is not going to do anything any different here. It was one of his political idols, was Stalin. And you know, and if you really want to indulge in backroom politics, boy, Stalin's your boy. That's the man you want to follow. Yes.
Was Stalin responsible for Trotsky's assassination?
Well, they might as well say that the NKVD did it. Of course, keep in mind, that's by 1940, and the purges have been going on since the end of December 19... Actually, you can get into the end of December 1934 after the Kirov murder. Sergei Kirov, the riot, and I'm going to touch on that, too. But Mr. Stalin doesn't believe in this proletarian revolution garbage. How can Russia be a world power, this proletarian revolution stuff? That's not going to happen. But if we industrialized... You know, you want to take your place on the world stage. You have to industrialize. So what is he going to do after Trotsky's out? He's going to collectivize the peasants for one thing, organize the farms. The peasants don't want to be collectivized. Some of them will burn their grain, kill their livestock, but between 1928 and 1933, you know, Stalin's sending out the collection squads to take a certain percentage of the grain and the livestock, and not only dispersing it to the cities, but exporting it overseas for hard currency. Keep in mind, the Depression's going to hit in 29. Why? Because he's starting his program of forced industrialization of the Soviet Union. He's going to bring the Soviet Union into the 20th century. He's going to focus on heavy industry, machine tools, tractors. Why should farmers or peasants here work on their farms with mules? Why not tractors? Can't you process the fuel, the food in a more efficient manner with tractors and do it more in an expeditious fashion? Sure you can. But what can you convert tractor factories into?
Tanks.
Making tanks in wartime, right? This is how Mr. Stalin is thinking. He's not really a communist. He's not really a Marxist-Leninist. What is he? A state capitalist. This is going to be Joe Stalin Incorporated. And what he's going to do is bring in a British and American and French engineers to help build these factories. He's going to do the same thing. He's going to do the same thing that the landed gentry did in the 19th century, and he's going to do the same thing the British are doing in Iraq with these tribal sheikhs who keep the people in indentured servitude. These people who are going to work in these factories, and they're sprouting up like mushrooms, these people who are going to work in these factories are going to be working 10, 12, 15 hours a day, 5, 6 days a week, underpaid for their work and overcharged for the shoddy goods they're going to buy. And this, and the excess profit, which is called surplus value in Marxist terminology, will be plowed back into the system to build more factories. That's what he's doing. That's what he's doing. And by 1940-41, the argument can be made that this country will be the world's second leading industrial power. By 1940-41. And you can say that because in 1941, the world tank population, when you take the amount of tanks that exist in the world among the powers, out of 40,000 of them, 22,700 reside in the Soviet Union. That's what Mr. Stalin has done. And he's created this atmosphere of having this country being surrounded by a capitalist West. Well, the British in 1926-27 cracked down on a Soviet ministry in London for spying. That's what the reason was. A Soviet plenipotentiary, you know, government plenipotentiary was assassinated in Poland. The Chinese are cracking down the Chinese Communist Party. Ooh, we have to arm. The capitalist West is striking against the proletarian revolution. You know, Stalin knows how to pay lip service to this stuff. And he keeps the country under a martial law type of setup. Beginning with the Kirov murder on December 31, 1934, he will begin the purges. Genrikh Yagoda, NKVD chief, will kill thousands of people, purge hundreds of thousands of people, and then he himself will be shot. Another NKVD chief, Yezhov, will continue the chase, and then he too will be shot until Lavrenty Beria comes along. He won't be shot right away. He will live to see the end of Stalin. That's a monumental accomplishment. And then he will start on the military. 1937, purge the office. 35,000 officers will be purged. 3 of 5 Soviet marshals. The entire 11 main political commissars of the Soviet military, they're all shot. Army commanders, corps commanders, some division commanders, even some regimental commanders, brigade commanders, even down to major and colonel. Some are shot, some are sent to Siberia. Konstantin Rokossovsky, who will be twice the hero of the Soviet Union, capable general, but he will have his fingernails and toenails pulled out by the NKVD, and he's off into Siberia. He will be rehabilitated later on, and as I said, become hero of the Soviet Union twice. How do you figure this? But then again, Stalin, you know, Stalin, the ever distrustful Mr. Stalin, you know, in 1934 finally joins the League of Nations and has as his foreign minister Maxim Litvinov, who believes in this idea of collective security. Align with the West to keep fascist Italy and Nazi Germany in line. But then Stalin takes a look at the picture here, and he says, the Japanese invade Manchuria in 1931. They announced they're leaving the League of Nations in 1933. Although keep in mind, you have to give a 2-year notice to leave the League, and so the Japanese really do not officially leave the League until 1935. Do you know they kept sending in their quarterly reports after they said they were out of here? Interesting.
Brexit.
So, beg your pardon?
Brexit.
Okay, there you go. Brexit, modernizing the terminology here. But you see here, 1935, Italy invades Ethiopia, takes it by 1936. The Spanish Civil War starts. 1936. Franco's a fascist, right? He's supported by fascist Italy and Nazi Germany. 1936, March 7. Hitler will send two battalions of the new German army into the Rhineland, which he's technically not supposed to do. Part of the Versailles Treaty, the Rhineland is that province of Germany that's right on the French eastern border. And up to 50 kilometers from the French border is supposed to be demilitarized. And so he sends two battalions. You know, some of his generals are like this. Well, supposing the French mobilize 100 divisions, what do we do? And what does Hitler say? Pull out? The French won't mobilize. Score one for Hitler. 1937, you know, the Anschluss with Austria. Austria is absorbed into the Reich, Hitler's homeland. 1937 as well. The Japanese invade China. The Sino-China Japanese War is on. A war in 8 years that's going to claim upwards of 15 million Chinese. Then you wonder why every time the Japanese there's talk about Japan enlarging its navy, then you wonder why the Chinese squeal. Them and the Koreans, they don't like that. Beg your pardon?
All of Asia.
Well, yeah, all of Asia. And even Putin, what was it, last year I think it was, bouncing off what you're saying here, Putin made mention of the fact that if the Japanese are going to enlarge their navy, we will have to reassess our interest in the Pacific. A fancy terminology for, I guess, we'll have to enlarge the Russian navy, I guess. But you see what's going on, and Stalin's looking at this. Stalin's taking a good close look at this. Sudetenland, the Munich crisis, September 1938. Remember Neville Chamberlain waving the paper at Heathrow Airport? Peace in our time. Remember that one?
Right.
And what does Hitler say? I have no more territorial demands to make. 6 months later, there goes Czechoslovakia, the rest of it. Gone. Another experiment coming out of Versailles that's been wiped off the map. Interesting what you're seeing develop here. And then well into 1939, Mr. Stalin figures, well, Litvinov's idea isn't working of this collective security. Again, he comes up with this idea, the capitalist West would like nothing better than to surround the Soviet Union. So he fires Litvinov and he brings in Vyacheslav Molotov, an ardent Stalinist. He will consummate the deal with Nazi Germany. August 23, 1939. You know, if the British and French don't want to play ball, I will play ball with somebody who will want to play ball, and that's Hitler. And of course, this agreement, you know, what's really trumpeted here is, well, you know, Soviet raw materials to Nazi Germany, and the Germans will send finished goods to the Soviet Union, you know, the trade deal. Well, that's the icing. What's the cake?
Poland,
that's it. Germany will get the western part of Poland, the Soviet Union will get the eastern part of Poland, and Stalin's able to move his border further west, which is what he wanted in the first place. And so another experiment by the end of September 1939, another experiment coming out of Versailles, Poland, wiped off the map in 20 years. Interesting. Poland doesn't exist really as a separate entity after 1795 till about 1918. And then 20 years it's wiped off the map again, and then it reappears, what, with the collapse of the Soviet Union? Hasn't really been an independent state all that long since 1795. Of course, that's what they say the Polish curse is, be between Germany and Russia. Korea is not much different, you know. Look where Korea is, between Japan, China, and Russia. Boy, that's a place you want to live. And so you see Poland wiped off the map. But then again, you know, in 1940, Hitler takes Western Europe for the most part, especially France and the Low Countries. Many thought he was going to get stuck in France. Of course, what is it Hitler says? The next war will not be fought like the last war. One of the reasons is the tank and the tactical support of aircraft for these swift-moving armored spearheads. Didn't have that in the First World War. You got it now, and the Germans are the world's best practitioner of same. Of course, you know, at the same time here, Stalin exercises his options. The Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia were considered part of the so-called Soviet sphere of influence, and he rolls in June 1940. He will also take northern Bukovina and Bessarabia from Romania, which puts his tanks uncomfortably close to the Ploiesti oil fields. And Hitler doesn't like that, but there's not much he can say about it. So you begin to see this frail Soviet Nazi accommodation beginning to fall apart. And in November 1940, Hitler will have Vyacheslav Molotov come to Berlin to so-called clarify the situation. Because Hitler's making a big diplomatic attempt to woo the Balkans, Slavs live there, into the German fold. And Moscow doesn't like it. And so on November 13, Molotov will arrive, and the conference will begin in the Reich Chancellery. Hitler and Molotov, boy, that would have been a fun discussion to watch. Paul Schmidt, Hitler's interpreter, so this was an example of heavyweight political discussion, making the comparison to heavyweight boxing match. And Molotov, you know, for glasses he was going to drink water or whatever out of, he had the glasses boiled. Talk about not trusting anybody. Of course, if I worked for Stalin, I'd probably want the glasses boiled too. Starts right off. Is our agreement from last summer valid? Is it valid? Is our agreement valid? Hitler says, of course it's valid. Why wouldn't it be valid? Because, Molotov says, you make friends with the Finns. And he says, people from Germany go to Finland. People from Finland come to Germany. And the Finns are dangerous people. They undermine our security. And we will have to do something about that. In fact, we are going to do something about that. And Hitler explodes. He says, I understand you quite well, Molotov. You want to wage war with the Finns. And I'm telling you that's out of the question. Do you understand? Out of the question. Well, Hitler's concerned with his iron ore shipments. 45% of German iron ore is coming out of Sweden. That went well. The next day, another meeting. Evening meeting in the Reich Chancellery. Sitting around this big table, right? And they're discussing Nazi-Soviet relations, and then the lights flash and the lights go off, alarm bell, you know, the RAF is launching a raid. It's a pinprick raid in 1940. This is not the mass 1,000 bomber raids. The RAF doesn't have that capacity yet. And Hitler and Stalin are under a table. Hitler and Molotov are under a table. And Hitler has the temerity to say, hey, you know, the British are finished. You know, Molotov says, if the British are finished, then why are we under this table and from whose bombs are we hiding from? But Hitler's already put in motion the plans for Operation Barbarossa, the attack on the Soviet Union, which will be the greatest land war in history. And on June 22nd, 1941, Hitler throws 3.3 million men against the Soviet Union, 139 divisions. 139 divisions. The very first day, the Luftwaffe destroys 1,400 Soviet aircraft. Second day, 600. 2,000 aircraft are wiped out in 2 days. Almost the entire frontline strength of the world's largest air force wiped out. First day, 3 Soviet infantry divisions, not regiments or battalions, infantry divisions, wiped out, 5 others cut to pieces. In a week, Heinz Guderian, that great practitioner of armor, is 1/3 the way to Moscow. He's 200 to 220 miles inside the Soviet Union. In 2 weeks, the Soviets have more dead than this country will lose in the entire Second World War. In a month, the Germans have captured an area twice the size of their own country. Now, this is not an impending defeat. This is becoming an unmitigated disaster. Yet this country will survive. And by December 1941, when the Wehrmacht's morale is at its lowest, and the temperatures are 20, 30, 40 below zero outside Moscow, some of these German troops still in their summer uniforms, because the idea had been they should have won by now, Georgi Zhukov launches a counterattack on a front more than 600 miles wide. They will push the Nazis back 100, 150, in some places almost 200 miles. 2 days later, this is December 4, 5, 1941. So they start this attack at night, you know, when it's colder. Imagine launching an attack with thousands of men at 30, 40 below zero. 2 days later, the Japanese bomb Pearl Harbor. Now America is in the war. Now it is truly a global conflict. A global conflict which in essence was started in 1914 by the European colonial powers. The British, the French, we'll throw the Austro-Hungarians in here, Tsarist Russia, Germany. You know, the war's not over in 1918. Versailles left the seeds for the continuation of this conflict. And Hitler will jumpstart this war in 39. Yet again, the Europeans won't win it. Two countries will. The US and the Soviet Union. The world is changing. These two countries are changing it. Why? It's interesting here. When you step back and take a look, these two countries are going to win this war because they got the three things necessary that you need to win a war in the modern era here. A large conventional style of war. Number one, they got large populations. They got large populations. This is especially significant for the Soviets because they're going to lose upwards of 25 million dead in 47 months. One of every seven Soviet people will die in this war. Large industrial infrastructure. I don't have to go into the United States. You know that you've been weaned on this one. Who else can build 71,062 Navy vessels? You know anyone else that can do that? I don't. However, don't sell the Soviets short. They will have the largest tank-producing combine in the world in Chelyabinsk, in the Urals, known as Tankograd, or City of the Tank. By 1942, get this one, they don't even have our help yet. By 1942, when the Germans produce 5,997 tanks, 24,668 Soviet tanks will roll off the assembly lines. And they don't even have any of ours yet. Can you imagine this? And 13,500 of them will be the T-34. Best tank made on the Allied side during the war, bar none. End of discussion there. You know, we're going to make 102,371 tanks. The Soviets, 115,000 to 121,000. This Soviet effort, and it's a great effort, by the way, Lend-Lease is going to be less than 10% of the Soviet effort. This country is going to beat the German army largely on its own. Sure, we're going to send them a lot of boots, clothes, trucks. That's the biggest thing we sent them, the GM and Studebaker trucks. Does that help? Of course it does. But when it comes to weapons, mostly all the weapons they will use to defeat the German army, they will produce themselves. Weapons they understand they can use on the Eastern Front. Many of the Allied tanks, we the British and the Canadians sent them about 12,800 tanks. That's only 10% of what the Soviets will make. And most of the tanks we send, they don't put them in combat. They use them for training or rear area work. In fact, some of the tanks like the Lee and the Stuart, the Russians will call coffins for seven comrades. Yes?
I wonder, maybe you're going to go into this, but, you know, we don't know very much about this industrial capability of the Soviet Union. And before the German invasion of the Soviet Union, Where was the industrial might? I mean, we know about the Ruhr, we
right.
know about Pennsylvania and steel and so on.
Detroit.
In Detroit. I mean, I'm looking at this map as part of your handout,
right.
where this Cheldon of this is located.
It's in the Urals.
In the Urals. But
beyond the range of the Luftwaffe.
I understand that.
Right.
Was that where a lot of industrial capacity was
Correct.
Before the invasion?
Correct.
Could you just
sure.
elaborate a little bit about
sure.
that?
Sure. Yeah, a lot of the industrial capacity was in the Urals, although there was industrial capacity in Western Russia, Western Soviet Union. And when the Hitler invaded, the Soviets will uproot, disassemble, throw on trains 1,546 factories and send them east to join the combine that's already in the Urals. In fact, there's a story that circulates Russia about a Yak factory, the Yakovlev Aircraft Company, and they disassembled the factory, loaded it on the trains. From the time, this is a story that's popular in Russia. By the time the factories loaded on the trains, sent east like 1,000 miles, and then reassembled, it's in production in 9 days. Now this is a country that knows it's not only has a problem, their backs are to the wall. And so yes, you see this huge, in fact, Chelyabinsk will be the world's largest tank producing center. What goes on here is absolutely fascinating. In fact, when the war is over, you go into the Korean War, and you know they're going to support North Korea and the Chinese when the Chinese get involved in that war. Upwards of 11 to 12,000 tons of supplies a day will be sent by train from the Urals to the Chinese border. Does that sound like America? That does. But what's interesting here, of course, once it gets to the Chinese border, they are not as technologically proficient in moving equipment, so a lot of the stuff is backed up. But 11 to 12,000 tons a day? That sounds like the United States, yet that was Russia. But of course, that's one of their aces in the hole because the Luftwaffe, like the United States, the Luftwaffe can't bomb it. And so this is just going on day after day after day after day. And then add to the fact that many of the Russian men were pulled out of the factories and their places are taken by who?
Women.
Women. So Rosie the Riveter? What? Maria the metal worker? You know, and so and on top of that, some of these women will wind up in the Soviet armed forces. I mean, one of the highest ranking snipers was a woman. She kills over 260 or 270 Germans. You don't need to be a muscle man to pull a trigger. You have a good eye, women can do just as good a job as a man can. That's what the Russians, and a lot of the anti-aircraft gunners, at least half at one point of the war, are women. And guess who else will do the same thing 20 years later? North Vietnam. Yep. And so you talk about a community scene. You know, in Pearl Harbor, after Pearl Harbor, you know, some of you folks know this, that, you know, it was, what was the watchword here? Remember Pearl Harbor? Almost like remember the Maine for the 1898 war? Remember Pearl Harbor. Well, we really weren't invaded. The Russians were. One of the catchphrases here was, comrade, kill your German. Get the implication here? Yeah. Yeah. Is that a lot more? Does that grab the gut a lot more than remember Pearl Harbor? I'll say it does. Of course, there's a difference here. There's a difference here. Despite the fact it was a race war in the Pacific, let's understand that concept. It's a race war here, but the Soviets are invaded. That's the difference. And so we call it World War II. Over there, they call it the Great Patriotic War. Stalin coined that because of the, well, you know, let bygones be bygones. You know, the trials and tribulations of the Soviet people with regards to those purges and the forced industrialization. And yet I'll offer to you that forced industrialization is one of the biggest secrets for Allied victory in World War II. You can say whatever you want about Mr. Stalin, but he took this country from a backward peasant economy to an atomic bomb in 21 years. So it cost 20 million dead. It's Stalin. He doesn't care. It's astounding. Yet when the war is over with, you know, this idea, and I mentioned this last week when I talked about George Kennan, this idea that begins to float. Well, Christmas, Hitler's gone, now he got Stalin. He's the new Hitler. No! Kennan was right. This country was not willing to engage in world domination. They can't do it at this point. They just can't. Sure, they can't. They come out, like the United States, they come out of it. They don't come out smelling like a rose, I'll tell you that. No matter how black-eyed Susan. But at this point, this is a country that, yes, they've taken over Eastern Europe. Stalin's looking for security at this point, not world domination. I mean, take a look at this. They got invaded through Poland and Ukraine in 1914 by Imperial Germany. They're invaded again by Poland in 1918, 1919, the 1919-1921 Russo-Polish War. And then the big one, Hitler, 1941, through the same area. They've been invaded three times in, 30 years? Even the Russian people, enough is enough. You lose 30 million people, are we stupid? We're gonna get out of this area? No, we're not, we're staying. Oh no, this is the new Hitler. Well, let's step back and take a look at the situation and understand why. Let me ask you a question. If Mexico, if we had been invaded three times in the southwest of this country through Mexico, three times in 30 years, you think Mexico would be a sovereign nation today? I don't think so. I don't think so. And yet, to add to this, this is a country that if you look at it, June 21st, 1941, and then compare it to May 7, 45, upwards of 70,000 hamlets, villages, and towns that existed on June 21, 41 were no longer on the map by May 7, 45. Wiped off the map. And out of the 25 million dead, most are men. You know, in 1940, for every 10 women, there were 9.1 men. By 1945-46, for every 10 women, there's 6.5 men. Does that impact the regeneration of the population? Yeah, it does. And a lot of these men dead are what? 20 years old to 40, 45 years old? Aren't those the guys that regenerate the population? Aren't these the guys that help rebuild the roads, the buildings, so on and so forth? This is a country that's going to engage on world domination? I don't think so at this point. They can't. They can't do it. But they are a world power. Can't deny that. And yet, what does Mr. Stalin do when this is over with? Now, he will, in 1946, Andrei Danov, one of the chief political commissars in the Soviet Union, he was actually the political commissar at Leningrad during the siege. An energetic Stalinist, to put it that way. He is ordered by Stalin to organize let's call it a purge. Now, the war's over. This idea of the Great Patriotic War. Oh, let bygones be bygones. We're all Soviets. You know, Stalin even opened the churches during the war. Reopened them. Anything to get the people going. Anything to get the people generated for this conflict here. And Andrei Danov is ordered. You know, the war's over. We need to go into the post-war world. And those who are not on the agenda need to be purged, such as some journalists, writers, teachers, even military officers, those in Soviet society that are not on the same page with Mr. Stalin in the post-war world are to be purged. We are going to do the same sort of thing here in 1950. McCarthy? Mm-hmm. Interesting how you begin to see the U.S. and the Soviet Union now parallel here as we go into the Cold War. Of course, Mr. Zhdanov will die in 1948. But Mr. McCarthy will have a longer run in doing what he's going to do. Interesting what you see develop here between the commonalities that develop between the two superpowers in preparing for what's known as the Cold War.